Welcome to Powered by Snowflake, a series where I interview technology leaders building applications and businesses on Snowflake. I'm your host, Daniel Myers, and today I'm talking with Patrick Barch, Senior Director of Product Management at Capital One. Patrick, how are you today?
Doing well. Thanks for having me.
So tell me more about your history at Capital One and what are you building today at Capital One?
Data has been in the DNA of Capital One from our founding days. We say that data is the air that we breathe. And then about 10 years ago, we took a look around and realized that the winners in banking were actually going to be great technology companies. And so we set out on this almost decade-long quest to reimagine ourselves. We re-architected our applications to embrace RESTful APIs and microservices. We embraced the open source community. And then about 5 or 6 years ago, we declared that we were going to shut down our owned and operated data centers and go all in on the public cloud. So we spent the next several years re-architecting our platforms for machine learning, adopting Snowflake, and really building a set of platforms and products for us to operationalize the cloud for our business teams because the market didn't offer solutions for us that really scaled to enterprise grade. Along the way, as we started sharing our story with the world, people would come up to us and say, your challenges sound like our challenges. Your objectives sound like what we're trying to do. Would you consider making some of those technologies available? And so we've open sourced a number of products. We open source Cloud Custodian that both Microsoft and Amazon have contributed to. And then most recently, back in June at Snowflake Summit, we announced the creation of Capital One Software, which is a new line of business dedicated to selling some of our cloud and data management solutions that we built internally.
So Patrick, you mentioned that Capital One Software was announced at Snowflake Summit just earlier this year. How has it been going?
Well, it's early. I mean, we've only been public since June, but early signs are pretty positive. As the product person, I love to hear some of the great feedback from our customers. We had one company tell us that in less than 2 minutes, they were able to find some headline-worthy cost savings opportunities. We were able to detect a cost spike in near real time for one of our other customers that enabled them to go find some unoptimized user behavior and correct it before it became a real problem. We've had some great feedback that no one else on the market is looking at warehouse optimization and recommendations the same way we are. And so, it's early, but early signs are very positive.
I love validation like that directly from customers because it proves the value that you are building. So that's pretty cool. Tell me more about how you've been able to transition into the cloud and why have you adopted Snowflake in particular?
Adopting Snowflake was one of the first decisions that we made when we were moving to the cloud. We were looking for a replacement to our existing data warehouse, and we looked at the market, and there was nothing else out there that offered the ability to enable our 6,000 analysts to run 3 to 4 million queries per day without impacting the performance of each other. We have a lot of load on the system, and Snowflake is really the only platform that could handle it. When we were an early adopter of Snowflake, we were an early investor in Snowflake. We believed in the power of the platform from the very beginning. But one of the first things we realized was, your fully elastic compute scaling model, if you don't put good guardrails around that, you are at risk of, spending way more than you thought faster than you intended. And, as a well-managed business, we needed to get our arms around that. And so one of the tools that we developed, Capital One Slingshot, is a solution that enabled us to essentially define the rules of the road of warehouse provisioning and warehouse management that then enabled our federated business tech team, so card, commercial, retail bank, they all have their own tech team, to manage their own Snowflake ecosystem according to their needs, but in a very well-managed way.
That makes a lot of sense. So tell me more about Capital One Slingshot and how does Snowflake fit into that product in particular? It's meant to manage Snowflake, but also how does Snowflake fit into the broader tech stack of Capital One?
We currently have about 45 petabytes of data in Snowflake. It's being used by analysts all across the company. I mentioned before there's 6,000 people. And it's enabled us to share data between different lines of business without having to make copies of that data. In the old world of data warehousing, when you ran out of capacity, you either had to buy a whole nother box or you had to play this game of like traffic jam where you're moving processes in and out so that you can fit everything on the same box. Snowflake did away with all of that. And so it's unleashed the power of our analysts. We've onboarded 450 new use cases where we're now powering real-time fraud detection capabilities.
That is incredible. So I want to see a demo of Capital One Slingshot. Can we see that now?
Capital One Slingshot is, like I mentioned before, it's a solution to help your company set the rules of the road around really Snowflake compute. And so we enable your central team to define policies that govern how that compute is provisioned, how it scales, so then you can enable your federated teams to manage it themselves. So from the Slingshot homepage, you can see some quick statistics about the warehouses running in your ecosystem, and you can check the status of any infrastructure provisioning requests that have yet to be dispositioned. When you onboard to Slingshot, we are going to scan your ecosystem, identify all of your warehouses, and analyze your usage data. And we're going to let you know, through this little purple icon here, if we found ways that you could potentially save money on that infrastructure. And so I'm just going to click this little icon. And through this recommendation, you're currently spending about $3,000 on this warehouse per month. We think you could save, by applying this recommendation, about $800 a month. So I'm going to jump in here and apply this recommendation. And the first step is to apply a little bit of metadata to the warehouse so that you can associate costs with the right environment. You can associate costs with the right line of business so that you can have an easier time facilitating any financial chargebacks at the end of the month. I'm going to put in here a statement timeout, which is the maximum length of time that a query can run before we automatically kill it. And now we get into the scheduling component. What is a schedule? Out of the box, Snowflake enables you to create a warehouse of a single size, you know, small, medium, large, XL, what have you. But that's not how your users use the system. You know, your load will fluctuate throughout the day. And so what we enable you to do is dynamically schedule the warehouse based on your peaks and valleys of usage. And so what we've done by analyzing this warehouse's usage data is recommend a schedule that makes sense based on past history. And so what we're showing here is on Mondays and Fridays between the hours of midnight and 6 p.m., you have a lot of load on the system, and so you probably need a large. But then after hours, from 6 p.m. to midnight, the load kind of drops down and you really only need a medium. In the middle of the week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the load pattern changes. And so between midnight and 8 a.m., all you need is a small. But then in the middle of the day, when your analysts are in there banging on the system between 8 and 5, you need to scale up. And then after hours again, from 5 to midnight, you don't want to totally reduce capacity because you have some after hours jobs that run, but you don't need as much as you do during the day. And so a medium will suffice. And then on the weekends, you don't have a lot of load, but you want to make the warehouse available should someone need to run a query. So all you need is a small. On this next step, you can confirm the details of the schedule that you've just provisioned and submit the warehouse for approval. And this will trigger a approval request to whoever has been configured as the approver for your specific line of business. You know, one of the things that we've learned through working with customers is, you know, not everybody has the same level of governance for their Snowflake ecosystem. You know, some people just want to create warehouses and be done with it. Other people really want to control costs, so they want every single warehouse to be approved before it gets created. We've developed a way that, you know, the product works for your individual use case.
I love that.
So now that you've got some warehouses provisioned, you've imported them into Slingshot Management, you probably want to understand how they're performing. From the Cost Insights tab of the product, we are going to give you a whole bunch of data at the highest enterprise costs level about how much of your Snowflake contract you've used and when you might run out of credits based on past usage. One of the challenges that we faced early on and that we've heard from our customers that they face is, you know, they're not sure how many credits they're going to consume, and so they're really afraid to like open the spigot of consumption without some, you know, some good controls around it. And so we give our customers predictability based on past usage of, you know, how many credits you'll have left if past trends continue. We also show you in a single pane of glass where you are spending on Snowflake across all of your accounts and across all of your cloud providers. So, you know, if you have four different accounts, you can see the breakdown. We also show you a breakdown of that spend by Snowflake cost type, because it's not just compute and storage. You know, you also have all of the serverless tasks that you incur cost on. And we want to show you where you're incurring those costs. We give you a breakdown of your spend by business organization. And now, this isn't your Snowflake account structure. This is your custom business organization structure that you've defined to slice and dice spend to facilitate easier chargebacks at the end of the month. And then finally, on this highest level view, we're going to show you essentially a trend report so that you can identify anomalies month over month. Like in this example, it looks like our retail products organization had a huge spike in April. That's probably something we want to go take a look at. Now, if you wanted to drill in further and see what's driving these costs, from our warehouse costs dashboard, we're going to give you a whole bunch more detail. Again, we're going to show you your warehouse spend breakdown by account. We're going to show you past spend and give you some predictions. We're going to show you spend by business org, by warehouse. And we're even going to show you the users that are incurring the most cost so that, you know, maybe the user is great. Maybe what they're doing is terrific. But, you know, if there's an outsized user like we have here, maybe it's a signal that you want to go talk to this person, maybe get them some SQL help or at least go investigate. And then finally, you know, one of the big pieces of feedback that we heard when we announced the product at Snowflake Summit was, help us write better queries. You know, help us with query optimization. And Snowflake does a great job of optimizing the query as it's been written on your infrastructure. And we want to help people up front, before they execute the query, just write something that's better. And so a first step to that is showing the admins or showing the users where they have the costliest queries in the ecosystem so that they can identify, you know, where there might be opportunities for improvement. One of the key pieces of feedback that we got from people who stopped by our booth at Snowflake Summit was, what can you do for me in the query space? Because in the old world of data warehousing, if a user writes a poorly optimized query, all it does is run for a long time and affect the performance of other users that are also trying to run their query. When you move to the cloud, now there are actual cost repercussions for people that write bad queries. And so what we've started to do here is bring to light all of the expensive queries that are running in your ecosystem to help you identify them and then go troubleshoot where you might be able to save some money.
That is pretty impressive.
Lastly, we know that you're not always going to be in Slingshot looking at your Snowflake ecosystem, but Slingshot is always running in the background looking out for you. And we're going to send you proactive notifications when we see that something might be amiss. For example, we're going to send you new recommendations as we have them so that you can immediately start saving money. We're going to show you cost spikes month over month to show you where certain business units may have increased or decreased their spend so that you can go investigate. And then finally, in near real time, we're going to let you know when we see more granular cost spikes week over week. And one of our customers has already used this feature to identify some poorly optimized user behavior and go fix it.
I love that this is proactive, meaning you can really get ahead of any costs that you could be incurring in the future. So this platform that you've built is pretty immense and pretty incredible, frankly, on the amount that it can do and the level of integration with Snowflake. Can you tell me more about some of the, you know, key features of Snowflake that you've used? You mentioned before that elastic compute, that zero copy cloning. What are some of the big features of Snowflake that has really been impactful to Capital One?
Well, to this product, first and foremost, has been the no copy data share. The ability to share data across enterprises without having to make copies of that data is really what enables us to power this product. We use that capability to share our customers' warehouse metadata with Slingshot. And I want to be clear, that's warehouse metadata. We never look at our customers' customer data. We have no desire to see it. You know, we're only interested in usage patterns that will help save you money. So that's been a huge boon for us. The second is the native app framework. When we heard about your move to native applications almost a year ago, I suppose, you know, we wanted to be involved from the start. We were always early adopters of Snowflake's technology, and we thought that building an in-product experience for some of these cost optimization features would be a great way to get them in the hands of consumers. And so we have an app in your private preview right now. You're free to get it. And so that's something that we're really excited about continuing.
I totally agree. I think native apps is one of those features that will be a game changer for the entire industry. Being able to bring the compute directly inside of a customer's Snowflake environment where it programmatically guarantees that their data doesn't leave their Snowflake account, that is pretty powerful.
Absolutely. You know, it gives, as a product person, I get excited about the ability to experiment with bringing different features to the customer in different touch points. Like there might be some things that work great in a SaaS application, but there might be other things that really would benefit from being closer to where the user already is in the Snowflake platform itself.
And so Patrick, for people that want to learn more about you and about Capital One Slingshot, where should they go?
They can go to CapitalOne.com/software. They can learn more about Capital One's cloud journey. They can see some of our thought leadership pieces, how we operationalize data in the cloud, and they can learn more about Slingshot. And if they're so inclined, they can submit their info in a form and somebody from our team will be in touch.
And I want to say a big thank you for joining me in the studio today. It's been incredible learning all about Capital One and Capital One Slingshot.
Thanks for having me.
And thanks to everyone watching. To see more interviews like this with tech leaders building applications on Snowflake, check out our other videos on YouTube and be sure to subscribe. My name is Daniel Myers, and this has been another episode of Powered by Snowflake.